Hi, I'm Dana Harris. I am the editor-in-chief of IndieWire. Thank you so much for braving the blizzard to be here. I'm really excited to bring you this next panel, actually the next to last panel of the Chase series. First of all, I want to bring up one of my favorite filmmakers, Alex Ross Perry, director of Golden Exits.
That was a really slow approach. I'll sit in the middle so that an actor can sort of break up the flow.
Cool.
Otherwise, I feel like I'm like the co-host of the talk show and that they're all the guests and they'll just slide down. And you wanted me to introduce the actors?
Yes, introduce the actors.
All right, well, we can put Jason Schwartzman in this seat. There he is. And in the back, Adam Horovitz and Emily Browning. And Annalie Tipton can take these seats here. Hey, look, there they are. It's weird to introduce people. You feel like, I have the worst voice to be an announcer. I couldn't introduce people. So.
That's allowed. So, I want to first talk about something that just it really struck me on a number of levels. I thought was really funny but very strange was the bit where you have singing in a very melancholy way New York Groove, and I think that's fascinating because I don't know how many people know even though that song. I remember that song from the sixth grade from the Ace Frehley solo album. I think I'm the only person who remembers that song.
I don't know.
Clearly. And so, but it's like, it's something that's like, I think of no one, and I've never thought of it being performed in this kind of melancholy fashion. And it's kind of sad and funny at the same time, and it kind of is a nice way to kind of set up the whole film. So talk a little bit about that, because I think that can help us communicate. Oh, hi, Chloe.
Oh, Chloe 70 is here. Hooray. That's like on like a talk show when you're just like talking about someone. It's like, oh, we have a surprise. Look over there. Thanks for coming, Chloe. Oh, this was the first question. That's true. This is just the first question. You know, it's one of those ideas. Well, first of all, so we shot this scene in the movie first. In Emily's character's apartment, where she sings this song to Adam's character, which was from an idea that Emily said after she read a draft of the script, and she was just like, "I don't know why I have this idea, but I think it'd be really in character for this girl to like sing a song with her own name in it." Because I just,
I had the idea because I noticed myself doing it. There's a song by a guy called Jamie T, a song called Emily's Heart, and I was like walking around my house singing that song, and I was like, oh, I'm the worst person. I'm like singing a love song to myself with my own name in it. That's horrible. That's like just an awful, cringy thing to do. And so I called Alex and said, this character should do that because it's awful. But go on.
Yeah, so like she has that in her, like she sings that song other times to herself. So instantly I was like, that's in the movie. And it was really fun to film, and it was really like sad and frustrating and kind of like tender and really awkward in a way. And I was obsessed, and I still am, with the beginning of Alice in the City, the Wim Wenders movie, where the main character is sitting on a boardwalk, singing under the boardwalk. And I also still really, I mean, I really love, just love it, it's great. And like somewhere in the mix of this, of shooting her singing Mandy with her own name in place of it, and then I was just like, this so clearly has to be the beginning of the movie. I love this song. I don't know, like I like the Ace Frehley version more than the original by, I think, Sweet.
Smile
is the original man. And I just was like, that's clearly the beginning.
Hello.
Right, I knew it was one. How could I forget that? And I knew it was just like, it just was, once it's one of those ideas that once you get it, it's just never going to go away. And it's never going to seem like there's a beginning of the movie without it. And like the real commendable thing is that I didn't go like full Magnolia and have everybody sing it and then somehow cut that together, because I did later think.
That's really commendable of me that I did that.
Well, that would be. I think that would be laughable if I just like completely did a thing that was in a movie, like you know, within our lifetimes. And it just wouldn't necessarily work. But like 2 months later, I was like, I should have shot everyone doing it just to have. And I was like, I could barely talk you into doing it. So yes, I don't think I could have.
I was gonna say that's why the song is so melancholy, because I really didn't want to be singing it, because Alex made me do it on like the, was that like one of the last days?
But it's really heartfelt though. It doesn't come off like you're reluctant at all.
She gave it her all. It was the last day. But it was just one of those ideas that like once you get it, it's never gonna seem right without it. And once I was like, that's the opening of the movie, I was just like, that has to be the opening of the movie.
So where did these characters come from? It's like, you know, and you should probably, you know, because I'm sure not the entire audience has seen the film, kind of set up what the, you know, what the film is about. It's kind of a interesting structure.
Yeah. Do I have to do this, or does someone else get to do it?
You guys can pick.
It's about two families in Brooklyn. Adam and Chloe are married, and Jason and Annalie are married. Each has an unmarried sister-in-law. For Chloe, her sister is Mary Louise Parker. And for Annalie, her sister is Lily Rabe. And then Emily comes to town for about 2 months to work with Adam on an archiving project. And she knew Jason when they were children. And this sort of about the overlaps and half overlaps and not quite connections of all these seven people.
So how, it's like, what was your inspiration for doing this? Is this a question of like looking at the kind of the ways that your own friends kind of interact in their worlds? Or is this a question of being inspired by other films?
Well, it's just, I work at home and I never leave my neighborhood. And I started to think that despite that being in many ways a very boring day-to-day lifestyle, I find it very interesting. Compelling in a way that started to become like a sort of pencil sketch of a narrative in my mind that over a couple months grew the more I became sort of analytical about what it means to just like some, like, you know, not even get on a train for like 6 or 7 days in a row sometimes. And I was just like, I go to the same coffee shop every day to get the same cookie at the same time, and there's always the same guy there not working. He just always takes obviously a 3 p.m. break as well. I was like, wouldn't it be weird if one day I walked in, he was just sitting there with like one of my really close friends? Sorry, I don't have close friends. Wouldn't it be weird if he was sitting there with someone who I casually know socially? And I'd be like, well, that's odd. I guess this guy who I see every day, who obviously lives near me, knows someone who, you know, how strange would that be? And I was like, that's, you know, that kind of gives me the idea of what to do with this archivist character that I like and this kind of younger traveling girl that I like. Yeah, and a friend of mine, so the archivist idea came from a friend of mine who is an archivist, who's done Nick Ray's archive, Norman Mailer. He's working on Bob Dylan right now. He was doing Renata Adler when we were shooting this movie. And when he saw Listen Up, Philip, he said, you need to make a sequel where Kristen Ritter's character is like 40 years older and her father is dead and she's making my life miserable. Because that's what these daughters do. And that is basically the Mary Louise character in this movie, with Adam playing like basically a grown-up version of my friend.
Adam, what was as the
my friend's a young guy.
He's grown.
Well, he's an adult.
Yeah.
But like if he
All right.
If him and Kristen Ritter were the same age, and then 20 years after Listen Up, Philip, it would be you and Mary Louise.
I tuned out after I said all right.
So for you, it's like, what, you know, what did you find to identify within this art, you know, archivist character?
Just the thing about being in a you know, like kind of dark room and just sort of obsessing over files, because I've done that for years, and that's sort of what I've done. And so I was gonna say that I like that, but I don't necessarily know that I like that, and that's what I liked about the character.
The fact that he's doing something that you're not quite sure if he actually likes doing.
I guess so, yeah.
And Jason, and it's like, you know, you guys obviously worked together on Listen Up, Philip. So, you know, when he brought this to you, was it just like, it's Alex doing it, so therefore yes?
Yeah, I had such a great experience on Listen Up, Philip, and Alex and I, you know, we met for that movie, and then we became close friends.
I do have one close friend.
We became, we became acquaintances after we worked on that movie, and then it was just such a nice friendship and working time that we had together. And he made Queen of Earth after, which I thought was so great, and then he called and said, I'm making another movie, and he really didn't have to explain what the movie was, because I just trust or I'm interested in where he, what he wants to try to pursue, and if there's any way that he would want me to be a part of it, I'm all for that. And I like the kind of adventure. And then he explained it to me, and it was really, I liked the concept behind the movie as well.
Well, it's like, what is it like, you know, what is, I'm going to ask this of a couple of people, what is Alex's process like? I mean, it's like, as you guys are friends, there's obviously a level of trust there, and is it just a question, is it a question of like rehearsing it a lot in advance, or is it more like trying to pick up the spirit on the set?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, yeah, it's a, what was it like for you guys? I don't know.
Chloe, you want to take that one?
Process. I don't. I mean, the set was very relaxed. It was very casual. You know, it was like very. Just kind of quiet and just kind of let you do your thing. I mean, I don't. You know, it was kind of easy in a way. I don't know.
It's an independent film. It's not supposed to be easy.
Well, the crew
it was very,
very
nice atmosphere. It was very like everyone was warm. Everybody like is you know. Wants to be there and is hardworking, working for Alex, and I've worked on a lot of his other films. So, you know, there's a camaraderie and nice hours, which everybody always enjoys.
It seems to me like he just has an idea, writes some stuff, gets a camera, gets some friends together, and then gets some people and makes a movie and doesn't want to, you know, overthink a bigger picture of that. Just has an idea and let's make that. Does that sound about right?
Yeah, I mean, it's just I wanted to work with a lot of these actors, and it was just I'll take any you know opportunity that people will be so gracious with their time, and I'm really just deeply humbled that people who you know like so you said you weren't home for more than 2 weeks all of last year, so like you work a lot, and like it's just amazing to me that people would carve out time to come and do something small with me, just sort of. Because it seems like a little experiment worth pursuing. So I try to be very like respectful of that and not take it for granted for a minute because like, you know, no one has to be there. It's just a total gift of everyone's time to me to come and help, so.
I think there are a lot of directors though that perhaps have a similar process to what Adam said. You know, you just kind of write a script and get a bunch of people and shoot it, and I wouldn't necessarily want to do that with most other people. I think there is something else there. Can you hear me? It's a small room. I have a fairly
Hello?
Loud voice. Is that all right? I just feel like I'm really loud. I think it is kind of difficult to explain what it is that makes it work, really, because it was sort of eerily smooth and easy. Like we sort of start working at 8 a.m. and finish at 5:30, which is
that never happens.
Never. But I,
yeah.
Right. Well, there you go. I mean, it, because it can't. I just don't want it to sound like, oh, we didn't even think about it. We just did it. But.
I mean, that is a crazy thing about production. It's like this is like the you know, one of the few industries I think where it's considered normal to work 12, 13-hour days. Like that's like you consider yourself, oh, that's a good day. And to do that, you know, day in, day out, and especially with like, you know, if you said you were home for 2 weeks last year, that's insane.
At a time.
I know, but still.
Yeah, I can't work longer than that. I lose my concentration. And I told everyone, that Emily was saying yesterday, I didn't remember saying this. She was like, what are the hours going to be? And I was like, oh, it's pretty, like, I guess it's kind of rough. I have to start at 8 a.m. every day, which to me is horrible. But I guess to the actors, that's like, I mean, what other time could you possibly start? What's the point of starting earlier than that? Unless you have to film the sunrise.
Also, like, I like to talk to people, and when I've worked with Alex both times, it's really like a, you know, the scripts are almost like just great. Besides being a movie, it's like a conversation starter, and I think of some of the, like, really nice conversations that I've had are with Alex about the movie or things that the movie, like we would go on long walks together, and it's romantic in a way, and have ice cream and talk about stuff, I swear. And although now.
You know, one of the things I really like about Alex's work is that it's very funny.
Thank you.
And it's also really uncomfortable. There's like, you know, it's like there's the conversations, the relationships here are, there's a, you know, there's a real edge to them. And it's funny, but it always feels like it's on the precipice of discomfort, or at least making me uncomfortable. And so I just kind of wanted to see, you know, is that your intent, or is like, how do you perceive that?
Me? I'm probably not the right person to ask about that. I don't know. It's just so I don't know how to answer that. That's a great reading on it. I appreciate that. Are you saying, do I agree with your?
Yeah, I mean, it's like
that's true false.
Yeah, true. That's a very intelligent, insightful impression of the movies. But I think if I thought about it that much, I would overthink it. I mean, it's just like starting at the beginning of this movie. It's interesting for me to have like a scene like in minute 15 of a movie where like Jason comes home to Annalie. We see him like he comes home, the house is empty, turns on the lights, sits down, cracks open a beer, and then 5 seconds later she comes in and she's like, what have you been up to? He's like, I listened to some records, I called my mom. And as your audience, you're just like, why is he lying about this? Like, what? I don't understand. Like, he just can't say, I was like, oh yeah, I met up with that girl, I was there until 1 a.m. He's like, I got home at 11 or whatever, and I've done it. It's just like, and she's just like, oh, that's so nice of you. So nice of you to call your mom. And he's just like, thanks. And it's just like, why is he doing this? This is like, that makes me uncomfortable. Because she doesn't even think twice. And she's like, oh, what a good guy you are. And he's like, thank you. What I'm always saying, and it's just instantly you're like, this is awful. Like, why is this happening? And like, she plays it so like, so sweet that you as the audience are just instantly like, you're not against him because he's not really doing anything wrong, but you're really like curious now about where she goes. And Adam and Chloe's relationship in the movie has a lot of stuff like that, and it's just interesting for me. I'm just, you never know when someone's lying unless they, you know, this is
know a lot about Japanese culture. There's a word in Japanese culture, I don't know it, but it's like a way of saying that the surface is calm, but below it is.
Yeah, I've heard the concept. I don't know the
word. I
felt that
when I was watching the movie, especially like Chloe's character as like hard, sad. And there's a moment too where she leaves the room, and then Adam's like going like this, like he's just shaking his head. And most movies, I feel like they would cut out because the scene's really, you know, could be over. And the shaking the head was a real hard moment to watch. And a side note, Annalie had a slint on her finger like the whole movie and hurt her hand and would go to the hospital every morning before working to do different rewrapping her finger and cleaning it and stuff, and it was very painful. So that's just a little side note.
I had that to deal with.
Yeah, it was amazing. It was amazing. Yeah. Annalie, do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, what was that?
I said to you yesterday that people all along have asked if that was intentional.
I had surgery on both of my hands the day before shooting. It was like one does.
That's crazy.
6-hour surgery, and yeah, the nurse at the hospital was really fantastic and met me at like 6 a.m. We were concerned, I think, for many reasons, but had to kind of go over since I didn't feel like I'd have to do any handstands, at least, that I could see. It was just about trying to make it as least visible as possible. But they're gone now, and I'm glad. See, I didn't actually see them too badly. Did an okay job.
Yeah, they're there a little bit.
I just remember it being such a thing for us. Like, I mean, it was like sad. See your hand.
So if you notice it, like Chloe, you'll just be like, oh, that's the character is wearing it, so it must be in the movie.
But you were also meant to have, like, the things you originally have were, like, huge bandages.
Yeah, because I went to dinner with you guys. Yeah, I had, I think the hospital was mad at me for having to take them off and then put them back on. So what they did was they would just, when I would go back to the hospital after shooting, they put me in giant arms, like, full-on things, I think just to make a point that.
Like what people wear, like, when they have a hawk on their arm.
Yeah, I couldn't go through doors.
Falconer. Okay, I've just gotten the signals that we can have a few minutes for audience Q&A.
Oh, see, I thought this was going on for like 2 hours.
No.
Great.
Do you have any questions from the audience?
Well, because no one's seen the movie, right?
Do you have any questions?
I don't know. Because, like, if someone saw the movie last night, it'd be very weird if they were like, I want to go to another Q&A with the exact same.
I was going to say we could act out some scenes live, but.
Okay, well, then I'm going to take on another question.
Yeah, go.
Going back to what I was saying before about having that kind of that kind of tension and energy. And I'm going to throw this out to the cast.
Music was great, too. Big shout out to the composer, Keegan.
Yeah, who was the composer?
Keegan DeWitt, who's worked on his movies. But the music, I thought, was really beautiful and very elegant. Yeah,
it was.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask, what is it like to play that kind of character where there is that kind of lying and mistrust and misdirection going on the whole time? It's like, you know, how are you kind of absorbing, you know, do you just see it through your worldview of what's going on here, or do you somehow have to take in the whole story of the script at once?
That's for the audience, right?
No, that's for you.
Oh, that's right. Okay. I thought we were doing audience. Yeah. still don't got it.
Well, my character's the one being lied to, and she's highly suspicious, and, you know, they'd had their problems in the past, and she sees, you know, repetitive behavior that's signaling that something is off again, and she's in it to win it, and she's got to figure out. No, at the end, she says, I'm in this, I'm, you know. And she has to grapple with, you know, the idea of this person that she's committed to and decided to spend the rest of her life with, that he might be going off, and does she confront him, does she not? And I mean, I've had boyfriends that cheated, I think probably everyone has, and, you know, so it's not hard to tap into that emotion. And I'm also a Scorpio and insanely jealous and suspicious, so came easy. But I, when I was talking to Alex initially about doing the movie, I was thinking about, you know, when I first started acting and I felt like I was much quieter and more internal, and I wanted to try and do that in this film, and he let me, and I really appreciated it. He didn't, like a lot of actors, directors, you know, push you and, you know, are only seeing what they see in the little monitor. I'm like, believe me, it's gonna be there. And they, you know, the stakes are really high and they wanna see more conflict and more this and more that. And Alex really allowed us to be very small, and I appreciated that. So thank you, Alex.
You guys brought A game. I mean,
you didn't even have a monitor.
Right. It's true.
Yeah, he just watches. I've never. Right, I, the only time I ever you guys. I
looked,
mean,
at,
us,
looked
guys.
At a monitor was when we were using like some sort of a dolly apparatus, and the camera's moving.
A
I just want to make
diopter.
Sure that it's smooth. Yeah, I just don't like it. I mean, I'll never get like, I can watch the movie over and over now, and it's what I would have seen in the monitor. But I could only like sit and watch a live performance of this, two or three times until we move on. I'd rather watch that. It's much more interesting. For me, just as someone who likes watching actors do good work. But yeah, I just loved watching the internalizations. There's so many scenes in the movie where everybody, but Chloe and Annalie, very much so, in this group, like, you can just tell so badly what they want to say. And it's like so apparent that like this is something that's really hurting to not blurt out. And it's just, they did a great job of conveying it without words.
Yeah, I was going to say, in that, when's your birthday? On the 9th. Oh, sorry. Scorpio, the 9th. Here we go.
We are Cancer.
My character, I think, my character really stays at home. She really only engages with Jason's character, and then Lily, my sister, and my character never gets in any of the drama. And I think actually that scene that you were talking about earlier, it's funny how it comes off, because I think a key for my character was to constantly make a choice to trust, but I've tried to approach it with awareness towards every situation. Which I feel like I've gotten a lot of relationship faults because of that, is it's just that choice to love and trust, but there is an awareness, and I found it difficult to do that with trying to forget the rest of the story that was happening, since my character really only did know that, and have to find why I would have that awareness and how. In my head, I had kind of more of a put-together answer for that, but I think you can see where I'm going with it along your question. It's an excuse to ask you when your birthday was.
It seems, too, it's like, you know, that's amazing that you don't use a monitor. I mean, that I, I know filmmakers who don't sit behind the monitor, but they usually do have one.
Yeah, we couldn't afford one, really, on this movie. Or on Queen of Earth. I mean, my DP and I hate it, because then there's just people looking at what we're doing. But, I mean, why, what's the point?
So what in terms of, like, you know, in terms of the budgets that you work on, it's like, do you see how you would, like, if I had more money, I would do something differently? Or, you know...
Well, I mean, I think the working method would be the same. But maybe that's why I don't ever get more money. Because I sit down with people and I'm like, so here's how it's going to be. Here's the crew top to bottom. And they're just like, no, we need to tell you how it is. You don't get to tell us how it is, so thanks for coming. Maybe, but I mean, I feel like, I don't know. I mean, we've like, the way that my first two movies were made, which were both like a crew of five people, and both cost like under $25,000, is like the exact same way that we're making these movies. You know, it's same DP, a lot of the same people are around, and it's just like, you're just friends, you're just here to hang out. Like, everyone's just on set. Like, even if people have private quarters, they didn't really utilize them. Like, there's like an office set where Adam spends a lot of his time, and like, every time we were in there, he just was in his chair. Like, the chair where his character is found in the movie is where we could always find Adam, instead of, you know, him being like, I just need to, you know, get away from these people. And it's just, it's very comforting to kind of create that environment, and hopefully, I think I'm pretty good at, I mean, I'm batting 1,000 at, like, picking, you know, or not that I pick, but being so lucky as to have actors who, when they come, they just, like, immediately, they're like, this is how this movie set is, and I'm not, like, I'm just going to have to kind of meet this, the way all these people are working, because they seem to really have a thing, and I've been very lucky. Everyone on all of my movies has just, like, instantly been kind of into whatever the method is, so I don't know. I probably never get more money. I mean, I haven't yet. I don't know what could possibly change. I certainly can't. I probably can't make any better movies than I've made. So I don't know where.
Check came out right.
furthering the game show motif. I mean, it would be a shame to give that up. Like, the budget of Color Wheel to the budget of Listen Up, Philip, is like a multiplier of 50, and it was like exactly the same feeling, just because we set the tone, and then Jason and Elizabeth Moss on day one just matched that tone, and then that was it. And then that gave me the confidence that in these last couple of movies, that's just the same way. Even though they're not being made for $20,000 anymore, it's still just kind of the same thing. And I'm happy with the results. I don't feel like there's a problem in the movies that I'm like, if I was a little bit more controlling, or if only I had that monitor, then this movie would just be a little bit better, except for one shot that was perfect that we couldn't use in the movie because there was a boom mic in it. Which, had I had a monitor, I may have noticed, but maybe not.
Please.
In all the filming, you know, because shooting on film, have you ever had an issue where anything was damaged or in the processing of the film that would have to, you'd need more money to go back and do something ever?
No, I've never done anything like that. That's not lucky. It's just having a good AC to package things correctly and ship them off.
Yeah, would you ever see yourself not shooting on film?
No, I don't really see the purpose of that, especially I'm talking here at the Kodak CEO the other day, the efforts they're making in that world right now. I mean, it's incredible. We've already heard good news recently about the return of Ektachrome, and he told me all this other stuff, all these great things are going to happen in the next 2 years. Like, the worst.
What about the labs?
The what?
The labs.
They bought a lab.
Oh, good.
He said just today.
And fewer and far between.
He told me, he's like, just today I bought a lab in Atlanta, which I guess has been kept in business by The Walking Dead, which shoots on Super 16. He was like, we just bought a lab. And they're opening one in Queens that's like already like a month past when it's supposed to open. But yeah, I feel like the worst time to make a movie on film was like when I made Color Wheel and Listen Up, Philip. It was just like basically very challenging. And now it seems like it's just going to get easier. And Chloe is making movies on film too. So more new people are like,
yeah, actually,
this is how I want
to
do it.
And this will be my last question because they're telling me to wrap up.
Who?
Oh.
Tell me who it is.
I'll sick you on him. So, and what is, as actors, do you prefer, have any preference for film versus digital? And because, you know, and why? I mean, it's like, and because digital's become such, you know, the big thing for people now coming to Sundance is getting your DCP ready. And, you know, it's no longer the huge, you know, wheels of film. But as an actor, it's like, what do you prefer to see yourself on, digital or film?
Film.
Why?
And I don't have a very intelligent answer for it, but I think there are a lot of very skilled people who can make digital look great. But film is, it just has a kind of magic quality. It just, there's something special about it. And there, like I said, there are people doing digital who are sort of making it look like film, which can be great too, but then there's the sort of other side of it, which is the super HD crisp, like it's yucky. I don't like it. It's great for like nature documentaries and
Chloe,
sports.
did you shoot your short on film?
Yes, I've shot two shorts now on 35, which were the short ends from Nocturnal Animals. I got a great deal.
but if you can, but they obviously like they both can have their benefits and their things, but when you're shooting on film, I think that one thing that I've enjoyed about it is that there's a certain amount of it, and then it will roll out. And you know, with digital, they can just like they'll just leave it going for a long time, which can, like I say, it can be great in certain circumstances. You know, depending on how that director wishes to work, but there is something nice about knowing it's like a contained thing. Time-wise, you know, physically, it will run out, and you go into it with that mindset, and it's kind of magical. Plus the Mitchell system and all that stuff.
All right, that's all the time we have. Thank you guys so much for being
here.
Thank
you.
Thank you.